new with us this morning, we've started a series a few weeks ago called The 9. And The 9 is about what are 9 ways to live wisely in life. Now, we're shamelessly using Dr. Henry Cloud's book, 9 Things You Simply Must Do in Order to Succeed in Love and Life. We're using that as our sort of our guideline as we move through these 9 things. But we've intentionally really tried to infuse it with a lot of scripture to really say, this isn't just good common sense. This is actually grounded in what the Bible is telling us about how to live wisely as well. Now, one of the things we've been saying all the way through this series so far, and I'm going to say it again, I'm going to say it every time you hear me speak about this, is that Proverbs 4:5 says, get wisdom, develop good judgment. Wisdom is not something that comes automatic in your life. Wisdom is something that you need to learn, to reflect upon. Wisdom is something that you need to practice, how to live wisely. I mean, sometimes we think like wisdom should just come to us automatically. It doesn't happen that way. The Bible says, get wisdom, develop good judgment. You know what's funny is that every other skill in life, we understand that we have to practice it, learn about it, listen to others, develop every other skill in life. Wisdom is a skill. Wisdom is a skill. So, as we think about living wisely, and I mean, I don't think anyone would say, I don't want to live wisely. No, I prefer to live as foolishly as possible. I want to live in a foolish, silly, stupid way. No. All of us want to live wisely. We want to be wise in our relationships, wise in our work, wise with life, wise in our faith. So how do we do this? Well, we are identifying 9 ways to live wisely. And the first 3 are this. Jen preached on the first one. It was called Dig It Up. And basically, Dig It Up was if you're going to live wisely, you need to go inside, look at your hopes, your dreams, your gifting, your aspirations, and say, what's inside? God wants me to dig that up and get it on the outside, okay? You've got to do the inward journey. The second wise way we talked about was pull the tooth, kind of a dental term, which basically means you have to get past the negative and unhealthy in your life. If you have something negative in your attitude or actions, or if there's a negative or unhealthy or sinful thing going on in a relationship between you or your organization you're in, you have to deal with it. You just can't go, oh, well, it's a toothache. I'm going to live with it for the rest of my life. You have to pull the tooth at some point. Last week, we talked about play the movie. That's the third wise way we talked about. Play the movie is simply doing this. The choices I make today, how will that impact my life next month, next year, in the next 10 years? Play out the scenes in your life. How will this impact everybody that I care about? How will this impact all the people that I know? How will this impact the dreams that I've dug up out of me? Right? So play the movie. Well, today we want to talk about another one called, here's the fourth one, do something. That's our message for today. If you don't remember anything else, remember the message of today, if you're going to live a wise life, is a simple clarion call that says, do something. Not in a judgmental way, like do something, but do something, okay? We're all called to be active in our life. Well, I thought, it's summer. Let's have a little bit of fun. I want you to watch a song here that helps get this idea across, and then I'll continue on in my message. So let's play this song, Matthew West, called Do Something. So enjoy.
This morning, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. Well, it's time for us to do something. Something. So tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy. We'll tell ourselves it's all right. Somebody else will do something. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm sick and tired of life with no desire. Says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. It's time for us to do something. Yes, it is. Come on. If not now, then who? Change the world by standing still. No, we won't stand still. No. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now. It's time for us to do something.
Have you ever found yourself in situations where things are not working out? You're frustrated. Other people in your life, they may be family, they may be fellow employees, they may be friends, they may be your neighbors, they may be citizens from another country even, that have made choices that have not made you happy. You feel troubled. You feel upset. You're bothered. You're ticked off. You're concerned. Or perhaps even it isn't people, it's just circumstances. Something got broke. You weren't planning that it would get broke, but it got broke. And now your life is in a mess. It makes life now difficult or challenging. You did not plan for these circumstances to work out this way, but they are there nonetheless, and you were not asking for it. Now, if you're in a difficult situation, whether it's relational or circumstantial, what do you do next? What's your next step in the midst of that? Can I be honest that at a sort of an emotional, internal level, I know I go here for a while. I think we all get stuck. We fall into what I want to call passivity. We say there's nothing I can do until the economy gets better. There's nothing I can do until that neighbor who offended me comes over and apologizes. There's nothing I can do about this downturn in my business. There's nothing I can do about this bad conversation I had with my uncle. There's nothing I can do. I'm helpless. It's hopeless. I'm stuck. You know, it's interesting that, to be honest again, passivity actually feels kind of good. Doesn't it? I like to think of it as a sort of a nice little warm blanket you can wrap around yourself and play the victim. And tell people how bad your life is. Yeah, this is what's going on. I have all my investments in the UK. It's gone to the pot. And everybody's going, oh boy, too bad. Too bad for Brexit. So what do you do? It's great to get pity from others, isn't it? It's a nice little warm drink to coddle your feeling of pain. You know, passivity also allows me to really wallow in my fear and cynicism. I mean, my cynicism kicks in where I really believe that there's nothing that can be done of any value anyway. And my fear is that if I even try to do something in the midst of all this difficult situation I'm in, well, guess what? It's just going to make matters worse. I mean, things are just going to get terrible. It's just more bad news. So I'll just stay here stuck and let everybody know how stuck I am and how frustrated I am. And I'm waiting for everything else to change around me. You know, passivity also feeds into, I think, a dark belief that we all struggle with deep down in our souls. Because deep in our souls, I think we all struggle with feelings of insecurity and insufficiency. Who am I? I'm just one little human being on this globe. I'm just one of billions. What does my little voice matter? What does my actions really matter anyway? What difference can I really make anyway, realistically? And also there's that feeling of insecurity that says, even if I try, what if I mess up? What if I take a step and it's wrong and people are going to throw snowballs of insults at me and say, yeah, why'd you do that for? Yeah, that was really smart, Dave. So it's just better to stay where I am and complain about my situation and let people know how much of a victim I am. And I wasn't asking for these circumstances. I wasn't asking for these people to react this way to me. I wasn't asking for those negative consequences. And I don't know what to do, so I'm just going to stay here and wait. Can I tell you that passivity is ultimately a real sin? Because passivity ultimately is focused completely on yourself. You're not thinking about the needs of others anymore. You're not thinking about the needs of God's kingdom, of where God wants to move. You're just thinking about yourself. And self-centeredness is such a profound sin to our souls. Can I tell you that if you're going to live wisely, if you're going to be a wise person, you're going to reject the path of passivity. When faced with demanding, difficult situations, if you're going to be a wise person, rather than saying, oh, why? And we're all human. It's okay to, I guess, have that initial reaction maybe. That can run through your soul and through your heart and through your mind. Oh, man, I didn't ask for this. This is a pain. But then if you're going to be a wise person, the very next question you better ask is this. God, what can I do to make this situation better? What can I do to make this situation better? Instead of just hoping things will get better, I want to ask the question, okay, God, I need to do something. You know, let's get a sense that this call to do something is grounded in our understanding of who God is. You know, we believe, and we learned this in the story that we did this past ministry year, the very first book of the Bible tells us something about who God is. God did something. He created the world. He created everything that was in it. He created us. I mean, God, the one we worship, is a God who acts, a God who moves, a God who's prepared to always do something. I think of what the psalmist says in Psalm 92, verse 4 and 5. He says, you thrill me, Lord, with all you've done for me. I sing for joy because of what you've done. And then I love this part. Oh, Lord, what great works you do. Our God is not a passive God. The God we worship is not a passive God at all. Think about what God has done. He created. He delivered. He rescues. He calms the storms. He draws near. He gave his son. He waits. He hears our cries. He saves. He prepares a place for us. He took our place. He calls out to us. Now, what I want you to understand is this. If the God that we worship, in whose image that we're made, is a God of movement and of action, we too, because we're created in his image, we are designed to do basically the things that he does, just in smaller measures. We are designed to dream up new things, be creative, work hard, rest, celebrate, make choices, love each other. In other words, we are all called to do something. Do something. In Scripture, Paul calls us to be imitators of God. In Ephesians 5, 1 and 2, he writes, "Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love." Is that not a call to action? Live a life filled with love. Following the example of Christ. Notice that the greatest work of salvation was because Christ did something. It says here, he loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Regardless of what situation we are facing, regardless of the conditions that we are living in, if we're going to live a life of faith, it is one where we are willing to do something, willing to act, and we're ready by faith to make a move. Now, with all that sort of preamble to think biblically about do something, I want to take you to the key verse that's in your outline, and you can follow along in your mobile device or on that piece of paper that was handed to you. But here's the key verse for the day. Listen to what Paul says in Galatians. Pay careful attention to your own work. I love that. Pay careful attention to your own work. I don't know about you, but when I'm in a bad frame of mind, I don't mind paying attention to everybody else's work. I love being the armchair quarterback, the armchair critic, just the armchair whatever, as long as I'm in the armchair. Right? But Paul says here, God wants us to pay attention to our own work. For then you'll get satisfaction of a job well done, and you won't need to compare yourself to anyone else. And again, I want you to catch this, for we are each responsible for our own conduct. We're responsible. I don't know about you, but I remember as I was a young person, my parents saying, "Dave, be responsible." It was like a bad word, you know? And often being responsible in that context meant, "Dave, you didn't take out the trash. Dave, you didn't clean up your bedroom. Dave, you didn't do the dishes. Dave, you didn't put gas in the car. Dave, you didn't mow the lawn." I mean, okay, I'm doing a little family moment here. I'm having flashbacks, okay? But for me, responsibility came to mean you have to do a list of expectations. I want to move your thinking from that idea of responsible to a much deeper sense of responsible. Responsibility is more about understanding that you are called to be an active participant with your life. Actually, let me give you a good example of responsibility in this broader sense. So it's a beautiful day afterwards. Some of you decide to go out and have a picnic in the park. That's Sarah Cogswell's idea. I think it's a really neat idea. Hope you take advantage of that. And you're having a great lunch, and then afterwards you say, "Okay, we've had a great lunch. It's around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm out there having a picnic with everybody else, and Jared is in the parking lot already. He's kind of distracted because, you know, he's got his kid, and he's trying to get his pregnant wife into the car, and he's not really paying attention to what he's doing. And as I'm bringing out over my picnic box and putting in my car, Jared backs up into me. Not intentionally. It was an accident. He runs me over. He breaks both of my legs. I'm screaming in agony. Everybody freaks out. Jared feels terrible. Says, "Here's my insurance card. See you later." So, anyway, we go to the court. After I get out of the hospital, I'm all cast in my legs and everything. And course, Jared has to take legal responsibility. He loses a few points on his license, and he has to, his insurance goes up a little bit, which he's not really happy about. But anyway, and he goes, "Well, Dave, see ya." Now, here's the thing. Who is legally responsible in that situation? It's Jared. And that, hey, it's okay to say his name. Jared's the bad guy here, okay? He ran me over. All right. Now, but now here's the thing. As I'm getting out of the hospital, the doctor says, "Dave, you are going to have to do rehab for the next 9 months because basically you got to learn to walk again." And I go, "But I didn't ask for this. I was just doing a picnic. It was a beautiful day. It's not my fault. It was Jared's fault." And the doctor would say, "Yeah, it was Jared's fault. But Dave, you're the one who has to be responsible for your own rehab. Dave, you're going to have to show up here 3 times a week and start to learn to walk again. Jared isn't responsible for that. You are." "But I didn't do it." Doesn't matter. Welcome to what we call existential responsibility. You have to decide and understand that the way God created you in His image is that you are called to be an active participant in your life. You know, so often the danger is this. When we run into difficult situations, we want the solution to be somewhere outside of us, rather than having the default response of saying, "No, God, internally, what do you want me to do?" We want to have, you know, sort of the Calvary come over the hill and rescue us. And we wait passively for that rescue, rather than saying, "God, what is it that you want me to do in this situation to make it better?" Now, I just also want to make a few caveats about this whole idea of do something. First and foremost, you know, the vision of our church for the next 5 years, I like to think it's going to go beyond the next 5 years, but I think it's a pretty big vision. We're called to what? Love like Jesus. Yeah. We'll get it by the end of the 5 years, I'm sure. Do you know that if you're going to love like Jesus, that means you're called to a life of activity? That if you see suffering around you, if you're going to love like Jesus, you're going to do something. That if you see injustice around you, if you're going to love like Jesus, you're going to do something. If you see somebody lost around you, you're going to at least do something. See, God's love made Him move into our deepest need, our lostness, our need for salvation. Jesus' love for us made Him go to the cross and become our substitute and our sacrifice. Jesus' love caused Him to do something. And if we're going to be followers of Jesus, we should be known as people who do something. We're not simply passive in life. Now, just a couple other caveats about this do something. I know that sometimes where we get stuck is this. You're saying, "You're right, Dave, let's do something." And that video is really cool, you know, do something, you know. But the problem is, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm in a difficult situation, I don't know what to do. You ever had that problem? You just don't know what to do. You don't have a clue. You go, I don't know what to do. What do I do? Well, guess what? Doing something that moment is saying, "Okay, God, I'm not sure what to do, but I'm going to take time to start listening, reading, thinking, praying, learning what my options may be. I'm going to sit down and talk with other people, people who care about me, people who know me, and I'm going to ask them, and I'm going to make myself vulnerable, and I'm going to say, I need help, and I'm going to say the three other words that men hate to say, I don't know. And you're going to say, I don't know. I want to do something, but I don't know what to do. What do you think I could do? And I'm going to trust that God is going to work through other people, and He's going to guide me through His Spirit, and He's going to teach me through the Scriptures, and He's going to help me just look at the truths of life in general, and He's going to help me say, okay, here are some options of what you could do. So that's important. You need to understand, even learning what to do is doing something. Here's another thing, though, that let's really be honest about this do something. I find a lot of people do know what to do. They just don't want to do it. Or they're too afraid and they lack courage. I mean, you've had a difficult conversation with someone. The relationship has somewhat deteriorated and broke down. You know that it's easy to be the victim in that moment and sit there and go, well, when he or she calls me, I may pick up the phone. Or if they text me or message me, I may answer. No. But you know, no. If I'm going to love like Jesus, I got to do something. I got to make the first move, even though they caused the problem. What do I do? Well, let's be honest. You may at that moment say, I'm too afraid. I don't have the courage to do it. Let's just be honest. I'm afraid. I would encourage you that if you are trying to do something that you know you should do and you're too afraid to do it, at least do this. Say, God, help me to start moving to become the person of courage that I need to be. Henry Cloud, in his book, 9 Things You Simply Must Do, says this. He says, you are doing something when you even decide that you say, I want to become that person to acquire courage so I can move towards that difficult situation. He goes on to say, addicts who take ownership of their addiction do this every day. They cannot do any better. They know that. But they can do better at handling not being able to do any better. Did you catch that? Addicts understand they cannot do any better. They struggle all the time. But they know they can do better at handling not being able to do any better. They get help. They take responsibility and ownership of the fact that they take control of knowing that they're out of control. They don't play the victim card anymore. They don't blame anymore. They take responsibility for their inability. So if you're saying, I know, Dave, what I need to do, but I'm too afraid. Take ownership of that. And you're still doing something. One other caveat about this doing something. There's a difference between passivity and waiting. Passivity is just, I'm not going to do anything, I'm stuck. Waiting is saying, I think that what I need to do right now is just wait. I'm going to let this thing calm down. I'm going to think. I'm going to wait. I'm going to pray about it. That's doing something. Intentional waiting. So, I just want to end this morning on just some real practical applications about doing something. And I hope I can kind of touch some buttons in your life. And as you think about your key takeaway, here's what I want to challenge you to think about and pray about right now. What is the one area where God is touching your heart this morning to say, you know what, I need to do something in this one area of my life? Yep. It may be in relationship to your calling, your vocation, your work. It may be in your parenting role. It may be in your marriage. It may be in your ministry here at this church. It may be in your relationship with God himself. You know God's starting to touch your heart and say, do something. And I'm not even going to tell you what to do because that's really not the point. The point is do something. Do something. So where does God want us to do something? Well, let's say, for example, you've got a business venture right now you're dealing with and you need to raise money. Go raise money. Go talk to people and raise money. Let me just give you a quick little shout-out story here. A couple weeks ago, Nancy and I were in Seattle with World Vision meetings, and I had the opportunity to talk to one of the board members of the United States World Vision Board. And in his earlier years, he's retired now, but in his earlier years, he was a banker, head of a major bank, and one of his first places he started working for this bank was in Seattle. Now, for any of you who are coffee pros, we all know that where is the famous company that started in Seattle? It's Starbucks. That's right. And if you didn't know that, you learned something today. Starbucks. And so there was Howard Schultz starting his Starbucks, had this dream of opening up these coffee shops, create community, have really high-end coffee, and spend exorbitant amount of money for a cup of coffee. That was his dream. And he went into this, and this banker told me that actually He was the first banker that Howard Schultz came in, was asking for a multi-million dollar loan to start his business. And he was the one that was going to have to approve the loan. And when he had Howard Schultz explain to him, this was 40-odd years ago, explain to him what his dream was, this banker thought he was nuts. In fact, he said, I still laugh about this to this day. I told Howard Schultz, I think you're crazy. I don't think that will ever fly. But here's the thing. He said, why did I end up as the banker signing over this multi-million dollar loan? It was because Howard Schultz had gone out and got big name investors to believe in his dream, believe in his business, and he did something. He didn't go, I have a great idea, but nobody wants to help me. Oh, poor me. Howard Schultz did something. You're depressed. Do something. Call the doctor. Go to a psychologist. Talk to some people for talk therapy. Tell somebody that you're struggling with depression. Do something. How about this? You're lonely. Go where people are. Show up. Listen more than talk. And see who God opens up in your life to start a relationship, a friendship. Your children don't show you respect. They mock you in the morning or at night. Do something, such as move towards them and find out where their heart is and where the breach has occurred between you and them. How about this one? Your child is going through a stage. Get ready, parents. There's so many stages. But your child's going through a stage. What do you do? Do something. Engage them in that stage. Help them navigate it. Show up in their life. Be a presence. Your workplace is difficult. Your fellow employees call it a joke. Well, how about this? Instead of mocking your workplace, why don't you look around in your workplace and say, how can I make this situation better? Become an active participant in your workplace. If you do decide to get this book, you can get a Kindle version of it. I encourage you to do. It's a great book for any age group. Actually, I was interested in this chapter that Henry Cloud was writing. He actually just gives list after list of things to do if you're going to be a person of doing something. I just want to do a few more shout-outs. How about this? If you're in a difficult relationship right now with someone, go and apologize. Go and confront. Go with an agenda of only listening and trying to understand how the other person has been hurt. Go and make amends. Get feedback from others on ways you need to change and find out how to do it. How about this stuff? If you're dealing with other people, get help to respond differently. Manage your expectations. Love them instead of trying to fix them. Do not depend on them for things they cannot give, such as approval and love. Oh, how about this one? If your dating life is not working, ask what you could do to meet new or different kinds of people. Join a dating service. Deal with dependencies that are making you coming across as desperate and needy. See a counselor about your issues. Call a former boyfriend or girlfriend and say, okay, why did our relationship really end? And they'll say, do you really want me to be honest? And then away you go. But listen up. That's doing something. How about this one? Get over your fears of making the first move and asking someone else. Deal with your narrow categories that are ruling out potential dates by being too picky or having the same, some type that you're looking for. The point is this. You can apply to any age. I'm looking at people here today who are senior adults. I'm looking at people today who are middle-aged adults. I'm looking at young adults. I'm looking at young people here. The question simply is this. Will you do something? In whatever area of your life right now that you're saying, I'm in a difficult situation, Dave, I'm being challenged, I'm being bothered, the question simply is, will you do something? Can I just finish on one note, though? I even believe that if you're going to deepen your walk with God, God wants you to do something. I think sometimes we treat faith as like some sort of mystical thing. It's like rain. We just wait for it to happen. Now, don't get me wrong. God is at work. He wants to know you. He wants you to walk by faith with him. But I believe God wants us to do something in our faith. And here are just some of the things I would recommend. This actually comes from an author by the name of Peggy Noonan. And this is what she suggests. Here are some things that you can do to have faith in God. Get yourself in trouble. She recommends that. Get yourself in trouble. Because when you get in trouble, man's extremity is God's opportunity. Secondly, when you're in trouble, review the situation you're in. And you could start by admitting that what you've long sensed and avoided knowing, that many of the joys and delights of this world are fleeting and some of them are fraudulent. And even though those you know best would never think this, you happen to have noticed it lately that you have a rather black heart and you have needs. And you know there's something not quite right with you. Three, you're miserable, convicted, and still on your knees. Here's something else you can do. Ask for God's help. Ask for his forgiveness. Ask for his mercy. Ask to know him. Put yourself in a posture saying, God, make yourself real to me. Here's another thing you can do. Just pray. Just have an honest conversation with God. What your day's like. Give thanks. Share frustration. Ask for God's blessing in any endeavor that you're facing. Here's another something you can do in your walk with God. Get yourself some friends who will support you and help you. Go to church and find out if there's someone there, a minister, a layperson who helps converts. For if you're looking for God, you're having a conversion experience. Make a connection with God's people. Here's a couple of final things you can do. Become part of a Bible study group or a prayer group where you can connect with God as other people are seeking to connect with God. And here's one you can do. Read. Read books about faith. Read your Bible. Read other people's journeys of faith so that, because what you're going to find out is that often the questions that you have about your faith with God, people have already wrestled with those questions. And as much as you like to think you're really unique, well, you are unique, but you're not that different from the rest of us. We walk this common ground of humanity. The point is, do something. Do something with your walk with God. I just want to conclude. Henry Cloud says this again in his book. He says, God never planned for us to sit back and allow life to follow the course of least resistance, becoming miserable, oppressive, unjust, full of mistakes, unloving, poverty-stricken, ugly, lazy, negative, and evil, without moving to do something. Such passivity is as far from reflecting the image of God as one could imagine. If you call yourself and you say, God, my heart, I want to follow you. I'm a Christian. I love you, Jesus. I want to follow you. Jesus is going to say to you, then do something. If we are going to change this world and build God's kingdom, do something. If we're going to take a stand against wrong, whether it's in our local area or globally, we need to do something. If we're going to make relationships better and reconciled, filled with grace and mercy, guess what? You and I are going to have to do something. And if we're going to live out the vision of this church, of becoming a church that loves like Jesus, we're going to have to become God's people where we all say, well, let's do something. Well, let's do something right now. Let's pray.